they're ready. We will be starting soon. I just wanted to make you aware we flipped two things in the bulletin. The Masonic Memorial Service is going to lead first, and then we will proceed with the church's service. And as soon as the Masons are ready, they may begin.
Friends and brethren, we who are Masons have assembled on this occasion to express our respect and esteem for our brother who has passed beyond our mortal sight, and to share with those near and dear to him our belief in the immortality of the soul. In this time of sorrow, when we all need comfort and consolation, let us turn reverently to God, who in the midst of the trials and tribulations that are a part of life, can alone endue us with that quietness of spirit and that peace of mind and heart, which the world can neither give nor take away. Let us pray.
O God, our Father in heaven, thou art the giver of life and light and love, our help and our solace in times of trial and sorrow. Thou hast assured us that when we walk through the valley of the shadow of death, thou art with us. Thy rod and thy staff comfort us. Thou art the light and our salvation, our refuge and our strength in every time of trouble. We thank thee for the life of our brother. We thank thee that he was one of our fellowship and that we were privileged to labor with him in the mystic tie of brotherhood. We are grateful to thee for the precious memories of him, which we shall always carry in our hearts. We thank thee for all that he has meant to those who were near and dear to him through the ties of family and friendship. Most of all, we are grateful to thee for teaching us that while the body is mortal, the soul is immortal. Though the outward form we knew and loved be removed from our sight, we have the assurance that thou hast taken to thyself his soul, which is the enduring essence of life. This conviction thou hast implanted in us through thy holy word, which is the great light of Masonry. We earnestly beseech thee that this short time which we spend together may renew and strengthen our conviction and our hope. Let thy peace abide with us now and lead us ever in the paths of righteousness. In thy name we make our prayer. Amen.
Somebody be.
From time immemorial, it has been the custom of Masons to assemble with the family and friends of a departed brother, to honor his memory, and to voice their sympathy to those whom he loved and who loved him. The message we bring is one of the triumph of life over death, the conquest of hope over despair. Masonry has come down from the far past. It uses the tools of the builder's trades as emblems and symbols to teach Masons how to build character and moral stature. It teaches service to God, to a brother, and to all mankind. It seeks constantly to build the temple of the soul, and thus to fit us for that house not made with hands, eternal in the heavens. Masonry is a fellowship that unites Masons in friendship and goodwill. It teaches the spiritual values of life that lie beyond the physical senses. Masonry confronts the facts of death with the greater fact of life in the immortality of the soul. Masons believe sincerely that when life on earth comes to a close, the soul is translated from the imperfections of this mortal sphere to that all-perfect, glorious, and celestial lodge above, where God, the grand architect of the universe, presides. With these truths and convictions, our brother was well acquainted. And though perfection of character is not of this world, yet we are persuaded that our brother sought to live by these truths and principles of Masonry, that they sustained and supported him, and that by them his life was made richer, fuller, and more meaningful. When Brother John labored with us in Masonic attire, he wore a white apron, which he was taught was an emblem of innocence and the badge of a Mason. By it, he was constantly reminded of that purity of life and that rectitude of conduct so necessary to his gaining a mission into that celestial lodge above. His soul is now clothed with the emblem of that apron. The evergreen is an emblem of our faith in the immortality of the soul. By it, we are reminded of that immortal soul of man which survives the grave and which will never, never die. In accordance with our custom, I now symbolically place this evergreen over the heart of our brother. And now to you who shared with Bear the intimate ties of family and friendship, we tender our affectionate sympathy. our hearts respond to your hearts in your grief. We trust that these affirmations of faith in which our brother shared may speak to you and inspire you to live with hope and with courage. We ask you always to remember that the God and Father of us all is a loving God, a merciful God, a compassionate God, whose ears are ever opened to the cry of the afflicted. Let us pray.
Eternal and everlasting God, we look to thee in faith and confidence, knowing that thy love has power to bring comfort and consolation, even in this time of bereavement, to those near and dear to our brother. Fill their hearts more and more with the blessed assurance of immortality and of thy abiding love. Bless them and keep them, O Lord. Make thy face to shine upon them and be gracious unto them. Lift up thy countenance upon them and give them thy peace. Amen.
So let it be.
Ladies and gentlemen, this concludes our memorial service for our brother John. On behalf of St. Alban Birmingham Lodge, number 233, Acacia Lodge, number 155, and the Grand Lodge of Ancient Free and Accepted Masons of Maryland, we thank you for this opportunity to eulogize our brother. If at any time the Maryland Masonic family can be of service to you, please feel free to contact us. Once again, we thank you, and may God bless.
Friends, I am Pastor Josh, and I wish to welcome each of you to Brook Hill United Methodist Church. Particularly want to welcome his family and share deepest sympathies to each of you. Jesus said, "I am the resurrection and I am the life. Those who believe in me, even though they die, yet shall they live. And whoever lives and believes in me shall never die. I am the Alpha and Omega, the beginning and the end, the first and the last. I died, and behold, I am alive forevermore. And I hold the keys of hell and death. Because I live, you shall live also." Friends, we have gathered here to praise God and to witness to our faith as we celebrate the life of John Bear Kirkpatrick, Jr. We come together in grief, acknowledging our human loss. May God grant us grace that in pain we may find comfort, in sorrow, hope, in death, resurrection. Let us pray. Eternal God, we praise you for the great company of all those who have finished their course in faith and now rest from their labors. We praise you for those dear to us whom we name in our hearts before you. Especially we praise you for John Bear Kirkpatrick, whom you have graciously received into your presence. To all of these, grant your peace. Let perpetual light shine upon them and help us to believe where we have not seen, that your presence may lead us through our years and bring us at last with them into the joy of your home, not made with hands, but eternal in the heavens. Through Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen. Now, if you are able, please turn to page 378 of the hymnal For Amazing Grace.
Thank you. I'll be reading Psalm 23. The Lord is my shepherd, I lack nothing. He makes me lie down in green pastures. He leads me beside quiet waters. He refreshes my soul. He guides me along the right paths for his name's sake. Even though I walk through the darkest valley, I will fear no evil, for you are with me. Your rod and your staff, they comfort me. You prepare a table before me in the presence of my enemies. You anoint my head with oil. My cup overflows. Surely your goodness and love will follow me all the days of my life, and I will dwell in the house of the Lord forever.
Please stand as you are able and join with me on page 504, The Old Rugged Cross.
Thank you.
seated. We've come now to a time of sharing and reflection. Those family and friends who have already agreed to come up may come up to share their memories. You're welcome to use the podium here or the microphone there.
Well, I cleared this with the one niece. He's gone. My memories, and I have quite a few of them with Bear. As many of you may know, he was a man with a big heart. I met Bear first time I met him was 30 years ago when we were both working nights, him at one club and I was at another club, and that's how we met. And we became best of friends, and we've been best of friends ever since then. We all know he's very active in the Masons, and I've known that from day one, and he's also active and with the reenactors of Fort Frederick. That I've always known. He was a master carpenter. He loved to work with wood. He was not a mechanic. So we had our even trade-off there. I'm not a master carpenter, I'm a master mechanic. So that's how we had our trade-off. Some of the funny things that me and him, you know, would do is neither one of us are men of small stature. Now, I don't know if how many of you know the old Cavalier SS cars that were about this high and about that wide. And you see the two of us climb out of this car from sitting shoulder to shoulder, door to door. And people would look at us when we get out of the car, and the car would raise up 2 inches. And they're like, of course, he's a little shorter than I am, but we're just as wide. Or we'd be riding in a golf cart together because we always loved to go play golf together. We didn't really keep score. It was just me and him out on the golf course having a good time. So, you know, and I always knew that if I needed any woodworking help, I could call on him and he'd bring whatever tools we needed if I didn't have them. And, you know, he loved helping kids, teaching kids. You'd always see him doing the reenactment stuff with the kids, all kinds of stuff like that. And he always wanted to try to help with the youth here at our church whenever we had mission trips. That's one of the big things that I always did. He always tried to get me into the Masons and into the reenacting, but I was like, I can only stretch so far, just like Jesus Christ. And my heart was at the time in helping our kids, because I'm a firm believer that the youth are the future of the church. And that's one thing we always would do, is we'd take our youth out and go on mission trips and repair houses and homes and make them better for them. So, you know, it's just some of the wild things. My daughter always called him Uncle Bear. You know, he could be a pain in somebody's butt sometimes, but, you know, he would always call me at the last minute or in the middle of the night. Hey, can you come get me? I'm at the hospital, or I need some help doing this. And I'm like, sure, I'll be there. He was a brother from another mother, and I will always love him. You'll always be my brother.
So I'm Janet, John's oldest niece, Uncle Johnny to me, and my sister Barbara. Funny story, my mother and her brother were 11 years apart. Her brother and I were 11 years apart. So it was more like I didn't get an uncle, I got a big brother. And you know how that goes when you're 11 years older. I got into all of his stuff. I played with all of his army men and made him mad. I got his skateboard out of the closet and took it down the street and wrecked it. And boy, I got in trouble for that and skinned up every part of my body doing that. But as I got older, still as a little kid, John's love for the outdoors, he really tried to get my sister and I to learn how to fish. And I guess he was kind of disappointed because there were no nephews to take over this, so he tried to make us like to fish. And I recall one time going fishing with him, and we would not touch the worms, so we had to get Grandma's Velveeta cheese and take it and make cheese balls. And he finally let us like put the hooks finally in the water, and we were going to catch some fish. And he told us that if we didn't stop talking so much, we had scared all the fish away, and we weren't going to get any fish that day. I think that was the end of our career as fishermen or fisherwomen. And then some more some more years go by, and I've learned to drive. And John was bound and determined, as Tony said, he wasn't a mechanic, but he would teach you anything. He was bound and determined that I was going to drive a stick shift. So my dad, who's sitting in the back, had a Chevy Nova, which was four on the column. I couldn't get that. So John had a pickup truck, four on the floor. Takes me out. He grew up in Seabrook. I grew up in Greenbelt. Two lanes going this way and that way. Gets at a stoplight and he goes, hop out. He puts me in the front seat and I have to get us home driving the pickup truck, four on the floor. I don't know how long it took us to get home, but we managed to get there. Some more years pass, grow up. Get married, have kids. My sister gets married, we have kids. Although he didn't get to spend a lot of time with the four kids, there's one missing. He's over on the other side of the world sailing right now for work. He adored those children and really wanted them to be a part of his hobbies, but just years and time just did not go for that. But I would say now I miss, it was a pain in the butt. He would call me every single night. What are you having for dinner? What are you doing this? How was your day at work? Blah, 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 blah. As many times as I roll my eyes now, I do miss those phone calls at night and was just like, ugh. I live near Baltimore. Can you come get me? No, it's an hour and 20 minute drive just to pick you up and do whatever it is you want to do and then an hour and 20 minutes drive home. But I do, we will all miss him. He had the biggest heart. He would hand you anything you needed and wanted, even if he didn't have it, he would figure out how to get it to you. He would take care of everyone. Before he took care of himself, I am just happy that he is happy now. He is not in pain. He is not stuck going to dialysis for 3 days a week. And he is finally with the person and has a whole heart because he was miserable without Darlene in his life. And I just hope that he is happy now. I did tell my mother to give him a big kick in the butt because he really put me through heck this past few weeks. So I hope everybody has a place in their heart for my uncle as much as we do, and we will miss him greatly.
Is there anyone else? Would you like to come to the mic? Okay. All right.
Well, a number of years ago, my wife and I and John and Darlene had gone up to Fort Bedford for a French Indian War reenactment. Well, all the firewood was about 2 weeks old, nothing burned, and it was miserable trying to get it. It took 45 minutes to build a fire to make coffee. Mm-hmm. So my wife and Darlene ran into Bedford to the grocery store, got some charcoal briquettes, and a propane torch. And that was the only way we could cook.
On that same trip, we had found out that about 2 weeks before where we were encamped had been a Civil War reenactment where they had tied up the horses. And oh, yeah. That's where we had to bed down and cook. So hence we got real charcoal briquettes.
Is there anyone else that has a memory they want to share briefly? Yes. If you want to, you can come to the mic.
But they said he worked at the Coastal County Park and Planning. I got started working there with Steve Caffrey. We crossed our paths with the historical sites there that they had, and we went to the one memorable event. It was one of the first times that I met. We were going to do a mock battle. And I was there with another guy. And all of those British started coming in. And we were looking around for on the boards on the land that's working this week. And so the woman, the person in charge, came up and said, "Well, this is the scenario of this battle." And Bear just looked at him and says, "We all die."
We will continue on, and I'll let you know that there will be plenty of time to fellowship afterwards in the Life Activity Center. We will have refreshments. And I'll just tell you, to have people laugh and cry, that is a powerful sign of love. So treasure all of that. Please join me and stand as you are able now for our next hymn, 377, "It Is Well With My Soul."
Thank you.
seated. Please join me now in the prayer in unison in your bulletin. Holy God, we are so thankful for your gift of the life of John Bear Kirkpatrick. Thank you for what he has meant to each of us. We mourn our loss, but celebrate his joyful journey home to you. We rejoice in the faith, hope, and love that has been showed on us by your special servant, John. We also give you thanks for your Son, Jesus Christ, whose life, death, and resurrection made his homecoming to you a reality. May we live in that hope of eternal life and be comforted by your presence in our life. Sustain and nurture us now with your comforting spirit so that we will not be overwhelmed with grief. Let our memories and love for one another as family and friends hold us together in the times ahead. All this we pray in the name of Jesus, our joy and our life. Amen. As we conclude, I just want to say that you are welcome to take your time. If you feel the need to pray at the rail when we leave, you're welcome to do so. And myself and Pastor Dawn, who is in the back, are present. If you just want somebody to talk to, or if you want to talk to each other, I invite that. There is not anything I think that is more fitting than a man who has had such a full life to have friends who are willing to share this time with each other. Now, may the God of peace, who brought back from the dead our Lord Jesus, the great shepherd of the sheep, by the blood of the eternal covenant, make you complete in everything good, so that you may do his will, working among us that which is pleasing in his sight through Jesus Christ, to whom be the glory forever and ever. Now may the peace of God, which passes all understanding, keep your hearts and minds in the knowledge and the love of God and his Son, Jesus Christ, our Lord. And the blessing of God Almighty, the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit be among you and remain with you always. In Christ's holy name, amen. Sweet voice sing.
Okay.